Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, save for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise his name, I'm fixed upon it, fixed on God's unchanging love. Hear the tune, thy love has blessed me, thou hast brought me to this place, and I know thy hand will keep me safely home by thy good grace. Jesus sought me as a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. Here to rescue me from danger, sent me with his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be, and with goodness like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Seal it for thy courts above, seal it for thy courts
Thank you for gathering us in worship today, Josh, and also your accompanist. Dare I say good morning? I welcome everyone who came out on what seems more like a winter's day than an early autumn one. The hymn that Josh just sang talks about God's grace, and we don't have any choice about what Mother Nature does, but we do have the choice to take hold of God's grace. He extends it to us, and we are to bind our hearts to him with it. So we offer our hearts in worship this morning. Let's pray. Holy God, with all your saints across the generations, we gather to approach your mystery and glory. We come with our needs, seeking the faith of those who have gone before us. When we are prone to wander, draw us to your love and light. Lead us by your word to walk in your ways. Amen. Josh, if you'd continue, we're going to hear a song of confession.
I thought I chose the surest road, and that road brought me here. So I put up a fight and told you how to help me. Now just when I had given up, the truth is coming clear. You know better than I. You know the way. I've let go the need to know why, for you know better than I. If this has been a test, I cannot see the reason, but maybe knowing I don't know is part of getting through. I try to do what's right, and faith has made it easy to know the best thing I can do is put my faith in you, for you know better than I. You know the way. I've let go the need to know why, for you know better than I. I saw a cloud and thought it was the sky. I saw a bird and thought that I could follow. But it was you who taught that bird to fly. If I let you reach me, will you teach me? For you know better than I. You know the way. I've let go the need to know why. I'll take what answers you supply.
Thank these musicians and Kay for sharing your musical gifts this morning in worship. Would the ushers come now and receive our offerings? We'll pray. Generous God, we're grateful for the forgiveness that is ours through your Son, for the graces you give through your Holy Spirit. And we thank you for calling all of us to be part of a community that honors each other, to be servants to one another with joy, and to share our love and material possessions. We're glad to have further opportunities through the ministry of Central Plains Mennonite Conference. And we pray your blessing on all those in this congregation who serve on its various committees. And we also ask your blessing on Pastor Amanda Blakety, and we're glad to have her as our new minister for Christian formation. Grant her wise use of the gifts of your Spirit as she guides our conference churches to grow and mature as the body of Christ. We are grateful for the many ways you provide for us. Receive our offerings now for the work of your church, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Oh, I guess we're supposed to not say it's a good morning. Wintry morning. One of the things we get to do, it's a privilege when we gather, is welcome new people into our midst. And this morning I want to invite Elizabeth Anderson and Brad Anderson to come join us. They've been worshiping with us for about a year now. They've been living and working in the community, raising their children and being an educator for some of your children. And they have, over the course of the year, explored where God might be calling them to call a congregational home while they're in this place for this time. And they have contacted their congregation, which they were a part of before, in Wichita, Kansas, Hope Mennonite Church, and have told Hope, we are planning, if the congregation in Freeman will accept us, to transfer our membership to Salem Mennonite Church. And so at our deacon meeting this last week, the deacons received that letter of commendation, of blessing from Hope Mennonite Church in Wichita, and heartily commend these two to you. You, the congregation, are the ones who actually accept and affirm new members. Others in the body of Christ who've signaled their allegiance to Jesus through baptism. But before we heartily say welcome, we're glad you're here, I want to remind all of us of what they are committing to and what you have committed to as members. In our beautiful constitution, the thing you refer to every week as part of your devotions, it's a helpful tool. It's a helpful document. I doubt many of you use it devotionally, but it would be an interesting practice. You might find some richness if you did that. In the beginning, it outlines what we as members are called to, what we agree to. And the first one, and these are, in their desire to transfer here, I'm going to ask them if they affirm these seven things. But I'm also reminding you, these are things you've agreed to. So there might be one or two of these you're like, oh yeah, I've kind of forgot about that. So it's a reminder, an encouragement. The first one is that, and these are spelled out a little more fully with scripture texts, but this is the summary statement. The first thing, we give our first primary allegiance to Christ and to his church body, especially the local one. And that's in contrast to some of the other places that we tend, or society tends to put their allegiances, whether it's culture or profession or politics or identities of other kinds. We are saying, first and foremost, as members of the body of Christ, we are committed to having our first allegiance, our first loyalty to Christ and to Christ's body, the church. The second thing we're saying is, given that we're loyal to Jesus, we want to grow to be more Christ-like. In order to be a member, you don't have to be perfected already. None of us are. But you are committed to growing in God's perfection, God's Christ-likeness, in Christ-likeness, in the image of God that you already bear. The third thing is, as you're growing, we agree that we will live lives, exemplary lives, that's a high calling, in conformity, lives that look like what we see Jesus asking of us in Scripture. The fourth thing then, so that's the positive, we live exemplary lives that look like Jesus. We also abstain from all kinds of practices and activities which, there was a list of things we're abstaining from, but in the end, we're abstaining from things that cause harm. Certain kinds of evils and sins and hurts and conflicts, we agree to avoid those things so as not to cause harm to Jesus or to one another. The fifth thing, because there are harms, there are evils in the world, we get hurt. We have needs. And so part of being a congregation is we say, because people have needs, we agree to bear one another's burdens and needs. And when there are conflicts and sin and evil and hurt, we work to restore one another to wholeness. So that's the fifth one. The sixth one is, in order to help bear one another's burdens, we need to be present with one another. So we agree to be faithful in regular worship participation. You all came on a snowy morning. You're obviously living up to this one. Thank you. And then the last one, assume responsibility in the ministries and life of the church. Some of you, that means serving on a board or some other's ministry. Some of you, it means giving to the offering which we just received. Others of you, it means remembering the names of the kids and saying hello to them as they go by. Others of you, it's simply praying for the congregation. We all have different responsibilities in sharing in the ministry and life of the church, here locally, in the region, and worldwide. So these are things you are also held to, and I want to ask you two, preparing to transfer your membership here, they're preparing to welcome you, do you affirm these seven things if you become members this morning? They do. I want to ask you as a congregation, do you reaffirm your agreement to these responsibilities? If so, say, I do. Okay. Having heard that, I want to have you turn in your hymnals to number, your blue hymnals, to number 794 and have that ready. But this is an affirmation that we're going to say as we accept them into our family here. But first, I want to just give you a chance. Is there anything you'd like to say about who you are? I'd like you to introduce your families at least. Elizabeth doesn't want to speak publicly. Brad, would you speak on her behalf? Can you at least say who your family is and where you come from?
Well, our children are Benjamin, Madeline, and Caitlin. Not that any of you really wondered about that. We are from the Wichita area most recently, but we've been in a number of different places in our marriage, and things were a lot more stable before we got married, and then we just went all over the place, but it's been an adventure, and we are here.
You're here now. So. And because they're here now, they find it clearly important to take their membership wherever they go, even when life, when you say unstable, you didn't mean between the two of you. You meant your
right.
Your home, where you lived. And if it is unstable, we'll help you work with that. We'll bear one another's burdens. 794, I think that's the number I said to you, is an affirmation that we are welcoming them at the commendation of the deacons and of their prior congregation into our body. So would you join with me in the bold part? And you all don't have, you can just hear their beginning. These two persons, Elizabeth and Brad Anderson, have now been presented to you and have witnessed to their faith in Jesus Christ, and they offer themselves as companions in our obedience to Christ. It is our privilege and joy to welcome them into our family of faith. I come from a tradition that still, that remembers the holy kiss, and I won't do that. I'll offer the holy handshake of welcome, having heard this affirmation from the congregation, welcome into our family of faith. You guys, you can go back and have a seat. When you go, pick up a hymnal. Let's share in our common faith together. Turn backwards to number 713, and we will reaffirm some of the common things we hold about our faith. 713 is a confession of faith let's offer together with these new members. Will you join me? We believe in Jesus Christ, who was promised to the people of Israel, who came in the flesh to dwell among us, who announced the coming of the rule of God, who gathered disciples and taught them, who died on the cross to free us from sin, who rose from the dead to give us life and hope, who reigns in heaven at the right hand of God, who comes to judge and bring justice to victory. We believe in God, who raised Jesus from the dead, who created and sustains the universe, who acts to deliver God's people in times of need, who desires everyone everywhere to be saved, who rules over the destinies of people and nations, who continues to love us even when we turn away. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who is the form of God present in the church, who moves us to faith and obedience, who is the guarantee of our deliverance, who leads us to find God's will in the Word, who assists those who are renewed in prayer, who guides us in discernment, who impels us to act together. We believe God has made us a people to invite others to follow Christ, to encourage one another to deeper commitment, to proclaim the forgiveness of sins and hope, to reconcile people to God through word and deed, to bear witness to the power of love over hate, to proclaim Jesus the ruler of all, to meet the daily tasks of life with purpose, to suffer joyfully for the cause of right, to the ends of the earth, to the ends of the age, to the praise of Christ's glory.
Our scripture text today is 1 Kings chapter 17, and we're going to present it as a scripture theater of sorts. And I want to thank Anna Waltner and her son Rhett and Lee Brockmuller and also Everett Waltner for taking part in communicating the scriptures in this way. You'll see two scenes, and in between you'll hear a short musical interlude. Ahab, son of Omri, became king of Israel in the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah. Ahab did even more open evil before God than anyone yet, a new champion in evil. He went all out, first by marrying Jezebel, and then by serving and worshiping the god Baal. He built a temple for Baal in Samaria, and then furnished it with an altar. Worse, he went on and built a shrine to Asherah. He made the God of Israel angrier than all the previous kings of Israel put together. It was under Ahab's rule that Yael of Bethel refortified Jericho, but at a terrible cost. He ritually sacrificed his firstborn son, Abraham, at the laying of the foundation, and his youngest son, Segub, at the setting up of the gates. This is exactly what Joshua, son of Nun, had said would happen. And then this happened.
I, Elijah the Tishbite, from among the settlers of Gilead, confronted Ahab. I said to him, "As surely as God lives, the God of Israel, before whom I stand in obedient service, the next years are going to see a total drought. Not a drop of dew or rain, unless I say otherwise." Then the word of the Lord came to me.
"Get out of here and fast. Head east and hide out to the Kereth Ravine on the other side of the Jordan River. You can drink fresh water from ordered the ravens to feed you."
I obeyed God's orders. I went and camped in the Kereth Canyon on the other side of the Jordan. And sure enough, ravens brought me my meals, both breakfast and supper. And I drank from the brook. Eventually, the brook dried up because of the drought. Then God spoke to me again.
"Get up and go to Zarephath in Sidon and live there. I've instructed a woman who lives there, a widow, to feed you."
So I got up and went to Zarephath. As I came to the entrance of the village, I met a woman, a widow, gathering firewood. I asked her, "Please, would you bring me a little water in a jug? I need a drink." She went to get it. And I called out, "While you're at it, would you bring me something to eat?"
I swear, as surely as God lives, I don't have as much as a biscuit. I have a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a bottle. You found me scratching together just enough firewood to make a last meal for my son and me. After we eat it, we will die.
Don't worry about a thing. Go ahead and do what you've said. But first, make a small biscuit for me and bring it back here. Then go ahead and make a meal from what's left for you and your son. This is the word of the God, this is the word of God of Israel. The jar of flour will not run out, and the bottle of oil will not become empty before God sends rain on the land and ends this drought.
And I went right off and did it, just as Elijah asked. And it turned out, as he said, daily food for me, my son, and my household for many days. The jar of meal didn't run out, and the bottle of oil didn't become empty. God's promise fulfilled to the letter, exactly as Elijah had delivered it.
Later on, the woman's son became sick. The sickness took a turn for the worse, and he stopped breathing.
Why did you ever show up here in the first place? A holy man barging in, exposing my sins, and killing my son.
Elijah told her to give him her son, and took him from her arms, carried him to the loft where he was staying, and laid him on his bed.
I prayed, "Oh God, my God, why have you brought this terrible thing on this widow who has opened her home to me? Why have you killed her son?" 3 times I stretched myself out full length over the boy, praying with all my might, "God, my God, put breath back into this boy's body." God listened to my prayer and put breath back into the boy. He was alive. I picked the boy up, carried him downstairs from the loft, and gave him to his mother.
Thank you, Lee, and Anna, and Rhett, and Everett, and Barb, for showing us these three scenes, or these two scenes from Scripture. In a moment, I'll reflect on those, but first, I'm a little bit embarrassed to say that I'm up here by myself. Erica is home this weekend. It was our 15-year class reunion, and I didn't feel like I would be able to make it with her, and so she went and took Eli, and they had an enjoyable time there. Eli ran in his first 5K race. I think he only ran about half of a K of it, but he started anyways. And Erica got first in her age division out of two, but she did very well. I'm proud of her. I was home here with the boys, with the twins, Jace and Luke, who are turning three here in a few weeks. And normally on a Sunday morning, I get out of the house early, even as breakfast is getting ready or before, and I come and make sure I've got my head around what Jeff needs for the projection, or if there's any last things for the worship leader, or and I knew that I would be needing to do something different this morning because Erica was not there to bring the boys, not here to bring the boys along. But I, during the week, kept thinking, I don't think I need to burden anybody else. I'm perfectly capable. You will see that I am a strong, independent, capable father. It's just two out of our three, and they're the easiest two. That's not really true, but I was sure that I would come up here this morning, have the boys maybe with some coloring books, and they could sit with me. They wouldn't be disruptive. They'd cling to me like Luke does and Jace as well. And then all of a sudden I realized, how on earth could I, in honesty, hear this story of a person pleading for help? Elijah, desperately needing help. And for me to come up here and preach on that subject without having asked for your help with my boys. And so, convicted by the story, I asked Amy, since she would be in, to turn on the lights and the fans and everything else, if she would watch the twins while I got ready for the service. And she very graciously, without feeling burdened, I don't think, agreed to watch them. I had second thoughts this morning at 2:30 a.m. Luke came crawling in about 3 hours before normal, coughing and crying, sore throat and a cold. And I was sure again, no, I would sit with him on my lap during this whole service. But as I laid with him in bed for the 3 hours until dawn, I kept thinking, I can't possibly preach on asking the church body to help bear my burdens. I can't ask you to do that for one another and not put into practice myself. And so again, I let the boys stay with Amy and Libby in the nursery. I'm not alone, I don't think. There are others of you who, maybe in my position, would know that you could reach out for help and there'd be people to help you. We've had help from a couple ladies in the congregation, a couple older men who have helped with snacks or cleaning our house. Thank you, Laris, for the times you've cleaned washed our dishes many times. And I've gotten used to the humility needed to let someone else help. And I understand how hard it is to ask for help in the moment when you need it. As people in a settler community, it's especially accentuated. I think our ancestors who suffered greatly, who worked extremely hard, were very cognizant in settling this land. You had to be careful not to be a burden to other people, because other people were also starving and having locusts and fire and death within their family. So how dare we not be strong enough to take care of our own? I think this is an even stronger mentality in West River, where libertarianism, independence, the machismo of the Marlboro cowboy, that's part of the code of life there. And we've inhabited some of that, even through the generations. We also, it's not just our context in a settled land that wants us not to be a burden to other farmers around us. We also hear it from Scripture. It's Jesus' words, right? Regularly, Jesus says things like, greater is he who serves others than the one who gets served. And as some of the Proverbs go, it's more blessed to give than to receive. And Jesus goes on emphasizing self-denial. Consider others as better than yourselves, as Paul quotes Jesus' ministry. And Jesus himself calls us to lay down our desires, sacrifice ourselves, and take up our crosses. So we have a good We have good grounding in faith to say, I'm not going to let others serve me. I'm going to be the one on my knees, washing feet like Jesus, serving other people. I'm not going to ask for help. To be a true person in the image of Jesus, living an exemplary life, is to serve others, not have to be served by them. To help bear their burdens, not be a burden to them. And so it sounds like good faith. I will take care of my own matters, and if I have to turn to somebody when it's really desperate, I'll pray. God can help me. God can go around the people around me and just help me directly. This morning, we see this in the first scene. We say, yes, God helped Elijah, who's in a desperate situation. The whole land of Israel and the surrounding environs is in a terrible drought, and it's going to last a very long time. And Elijah doesn't turn to other people. He lets God take care of his needs for him. Elijah doesn't ask to be a burden on Ahab or on anyone, any of his neighbors. He goes off into the wilderness where God lets the unclean ravens, which is an odd thing for God to have used, and the brook and the goodness of the land, even in a drought, feed him. God takes care of the needs. But then the second scene. After God has commanded the ravens, eventually that initial help from God that comes unmediated through other people, just through the creation, dries up. Even that command from God isn't enough to sustain this incredible drought. This drought is so bad that God's first plan runs out. And so God enters phase two. And this time God commands, same verb, a widow over in the neighboring country to provide for Elijah. Now it's incredibly unlikely as the ravens coming to him with meat in the desert, it is equally unlikely that, or absurd, that Elijah would go out of his homeland, even though there is a drought, go far away to the enemy land from an enemy person, and don't just go to like one of their soldiers or one of their businessmen or one of their farmers, go to the enemy land, an enemy person of the lowest, worst economic setting. God sends Elijah to this woman who is a widow. She's lost her husband, her means of inheritance, her means of finances. She's clearly destitute just because she's a widow, and we see it in the story. She has one final meal left. She's probably been withholding it for weeks, and she's now ready to die with her son. How absurd is it that God commands Elijah to go to her and ask for help? If that isn't a terrible example of burdening those who shouldn't be burdened. But God says, I have commanded her to help you. I have a hard time wrapping my head around this story because Elijah seems so rude or so brash. I mean, first of all, it's weird that he would go to the enemy and not some of his own home people. But then to see that she's got nothing, she's a widow, she's got a son to care for, that she has no food, and he still says, go ahead and make your food, but feed me first. And while you're at it, give me some water, and while you're at it, bring me some food. Now, I'm not saying that everything in the Old Testament, in fact, most things in the Old Testament, are negative examples for us. So I can't automatically say that this is a positive example for us, that we should go out today and find the neediest person in our community and walk up to their door and say, let me stay here rent-free for the rest of this month. Why don't you pay my mortgage? Why don't you, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not saying that's the example. God is not calling us here to go out and find the most destitute person in our community, knock on their door and say, I need your help. But I do see in this passage God's encouragement to us to go ahead and be willing to ask for help, even when it seems like it might be a burden to someone else, even when it doesn't seem like necessarily the exact right person. God has said, both through the ravens in the wilderness and this unlikely widow, I'm going to provide life for you, Elijah, my servant. And so Elijah, whose faith is tested here, he sees, why should I ask this woman? But in the back of his mind, he's probably going, well, God asked me to ask, so I will. And Elijah asks the woman to feed him, and also obviously not wanting to burden her to death, promises that God will make sure that she has enough to sustain her as well. One of the things we see in this story is that it is not an either or when we need to get help. Some of us imbibing the call to serve others rather than be served, to give rather than to receive, to consider others as better than ourselves, never want to be a burden to others. And so when we have a need, we take care of ourselves, or if we have to, we go to God and let God take care of it. But as we see in the second scene, sometimes God uses our reliance on other people to provide. It's not either God helps me or somebody else is going to help me. Sometimes God uses that somebody else to help me. And Elijah has to go and ask. Elijah has to go and say, "I'm also hungry. Would you be willing to share?" In Central Plains, we have a covenant of spiritual practices. We're trying to build unity around things we do together that drive us into the likeness of Jesus. And the preamble to that covenant, there we go. It says this: in response to God's unqualified love for us, we covenant to these six common practices through which we submit ourselves completely to the purposes of God, who longs to transform us into the likeness of Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit. Whew, Dave's got some long wind. But it says a lot, and it's in the spirit of the Apostle Paul, who also goes on for many words. We covenant to do six practices together, not because we think it's going to get us good things or going to drive our unity, but we do it because, first of all, God has loved us. Unqualified doesn't mean God is not qualified. It means God doesn't put limits or qualifications on his love. In response to the life-giving promises of God, the promises to feed us in the desert or feed us by the enemy hand, in response to that kind of love from God that has no boundaries, we covenant to these common practices so that we could be submitted completely to God's purposes and be made into the likeness of Jesus. Among those six practices is this one, spiritual practice number 4. We will accept and offer hospitality, believing that it creates the context for God's kingdom to appear in our midst, particularly as we minister to the poor, the hungry, the prisoner, and the stranger. When some of you have seen this in the past year, couple years, when the delegates look at this, they go, yes, we as Mennonites can really affirm that this is part of our calling, to offer hospitality, especially to poor, hungry, prisoners, and strangers. To offer hospitality, that is a clear calling. But if you'll notice, the order is not how we typically read it. The first practice is we will accept hospitality. In this story from Elijah, he doesn't start out by offering something good to the widow. He starts out by saying, "I'm hungry. I need something to eat." It's only later that he offers some hospitality back. Oh, and by the way, if you do that, there'll be enough in your pot for a while. The spiritual practice we're being encouraged to do is one that we see here in this text. One of not just being the servants, but also of being those being served. And this is very intentional, because there's something very vulnerable, something very stretching, something that offers a chance for us to grow when we have to release the power of the server and receive service. There's something very powerful that can happen to us when we are vulnerable enough to tell others what we need, that we are hurting, that we need them, that we have no power left. There's an incredibly important spiritual transformation that can happen when we release our privilege and our power to let somebody else take care of us. And it is almost probably as central to our faith as taking care of others. And we don't just do it because it's one of those pull yourself up by your bootstraps, bear your cross kind of thing. We do it because we believe that when there's both accepting and offering hospitality, that mutual back and forth, asking for food and promising abundance, we believe that it creates the context, the proper place for which God's kingdom can show up in our midst. And particularly as we're in the midst of the poor, the hungry, the stranger, and the prisoner. We see that in this story. Elijah is willing to do both ask for his need and also offer a little back. And in the mutual exchange, taking care of each other, God's life shows up. The third scene of the story is this one. Sometime later, the son of the woman who owned the house became ill. His condition grew worse and worse, and finally he stopped breathing. And the woman said to Elijah, "What do you have against me, O man of God? Did you simply come here to remind me of my sin and kill my son?" She's not a very grateful host. She's an honest host. "You came here and took my food, and now you've made my son sick." And Elijah responds with this. This is verse 19 of chapter 17, 1 Kings 17, verse 19. "Give me your son," Elijah replied, and he took him from her arms, carried him to the upper room where he was staying. So obviously this woman, though she's burdened by him, continues to house him. And Elijah lays the son on the bed. Then he cries out to the Lord, "Lord, my God, have you brought tragedy on this widow that I'm staying with by causing her son to die?" He feels empathy for his host's predicament and wants God to do something about it. So this powerful prophet prays that God's life would be for her and her son also, not just for Elijah. So he stretches himself out on the boy three times, cries out to the Lord, "Lord, my God, let this boy's life return to him." And Yahweh, the Lord, heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returns to him, and the boy lives. And then we see this woman, he carries the boy down, as Lee did so strongly, to the mother, and the mother says, "Now I know that you are a man of God, and the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth." In the instance of being able to accept the hospitality, Elijah accepts room and board, accepts a meal from a starving woman, and then he has the opportunity to offer that back. When the woman's son finally does die, even though he's had enough to eat, he offers his part, bearing the burden, going to God in fervent prayer, "Lord, why have you done this? Save him." And he does, and in the mutual exchange, the kingdom of God, the life-giving presence of God, shows up in that household, in the exchange between the two of them. And the woman, who was a pagan, probably a Baal worshiper, the enemy god from an enemy country, says, "Ah, now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is truth." This was an evangelistic encounter through a mutual, vulnerable exchange of hospitality, of bearing one another's burdens. And in doing that, the presence of God, God's kingdom, appears in their midst, the life-giving work of God. This is all set in the larger story of Kings, in which God, Yahweh, is battling with Baal, the other husbands, the other gods. And there's a battle going on between which of these gods brings life. And basically, this story is key in illustrating that it is Yahweh, Israel's God, not Baal, the god of Syria and the other places, that is the one who brings life. These three miracles, plus some others, the one that's to come is the Baal worshippers versus Elijah on Mount Carmel. And these battles between the gods show that our God, that Elijah's God, that Israel's God, is the only one who truly brings life. The other gods of this world are completely unable, and it is made clear through receiving hospitality, through Elijah asking for help. So what does this mean for us? We're working actually at exchange, and because of the way harvest is going, it doesn't look like we'll get to do it this fall. But we're looking to practice receiving hospitality, not just offering it, by taking a trip to another congregation and letting them house us over the weekend. With the harvest the way it's going, I'm not quite sure this may have to be in the fall, after the winter, after everything's frozen. But we're encouraging you, a carload or a couple carloads from this congregation, to go and impose on another congregation for a weekend. Receive their hospitality. Learn from them. And maybe give something back. And in the midst of that mutual exchange, God's kingdom might appear in our midst. We might find out something about God. For most of us who won't travel to another congregation to do that, here in this place, I encourage you, feel free, as Elijah is free, to share your needs with others, to ask for help, to ask for prayer, to let us know when you went to the hospital or can't manage things at home on your own or need somebody to wash your dishes. Don't hesitate to ask for help. Elijah comes off as a little brash, a little overbearing, but in the end, his willingness to be vulnerable and receive care from another person allows God's presence, God's life, to show up in the midst of that household. May God's presence and life show up in our midst this week as we receive care from one another. May it be so.
I'll let Barb stay in her seat. If you want to turn to number 307, and I think Kay's going to come up, I invite you to respond with a commitment to be cared for by another. Number 307 is a familiar hymn, "Will You Let Me Be Your Servant?" And I invite you to hear other people singing this to you. They are asking you if they can serve you. So often we sing this as I'm serving whoever I'm singing it to. I invite you to sit a little quietly and listen to your neighbors, or at least hear your neighbors singing this to you, asking if they can be your servant. Let's stay seated for this, because we'll move around a little later for prayer. But let's sing 307 together. Let's sing verses 1, 3, and 4. May God answer our prayer to allow others to serve us. One of the ways we do that regularly each week is to ask one another for prayer. And so the ushers are going to come forward. They have two microphones, or they're going to grab microphones. And if you have something to share, if you have help you need, or some other vulnerable need for hospitality or care, this is the time to share that. If there are other things, go ahead.
Hello? This is Anna Waltner. First, I invite all of you to come to my house and do my laundry and dishes anytime, because 100% guarantee there's something that needs to be done. Second, I'd like to introduce Joanna. She's staying with us for a bit. She's 11, and she fits right in very well. So please welcome her. Thank you.
This is Dennis. Just to remind you that tomorrow is the deadline to register for the MDS annual region meeting, and you're free to register just for the Friday evening program and banquet, or for the whole session. Thank you.
Peggy?
On behalf of the Board of Outreach, I just want to make sure you know, see the announcement in the bulletin, that we will be again collecting items for the Bethany Food Pantry until the end of the month. So there's an opportunity to serve.
This is Pastor Bob. In a little less than a month, on November 11th, we will be having our, what we used to call the grief and the holidays meeting to share together. We just got through singing about sharing joys and sorrows with one another, and that's what this meeting is for, to share with one another who have experienced loss and sorrow or grief in their life. It is also a time of memorial, where you can come and memorialize and remember those who you have lost. The time has been changed this year. It'll be at 4:00 in the afternoon rather than in the evening, hoping that that might accommodate some of your schedules, especially those who don't like to drive at night. November 11.
Well, I'm thinking of congregational losses. There was news this week that Marilyn Graber, Eugene Graber's wife, passed away Wednesday at Teasenholm, where they were both residing. Her funeral will be in Colton, South Dakota, which is north of Sioux Falls, about an hour from here, on Tuesday at 1:30 at First Lutheran Church. But if you want to visit the family locally, tomorrow night from 5 to 7, there'll be a visitation at Walters. This visitation, this care for this family, for Eugene and his children and her children, will actually overlap a little bit. We have a worship service also here. There's a guest group from Goshen College called The Parables, or Parables, and they'll be leading an evening of worship here at 7 p.m. So it is possible to do both, but there is a little bit of overlap tomorrow night between our worship service and the visitation at Walters. Were there any others? Oh, yes, here's a joyful one.
Yeah, I've got an announcement this morning. My wife was supposed to do this, but she's sitting in the back, and I suppose she'll reprimand me for whatever I say. But we are pleased to announce Susan and Benjamin Harder had a baby boy last night. So another 9 pound 3 ouncer to add to the rest of them. I think they all average 9 pounds so far. So they got a good start, 20 and a half inches long. Roy Willis is the name. So that's it.
Thank you for sharing these things. I'm going to invite Barb. She, as worship leader, she has a few instructions for a way for us to actually put into practice in a very tangible way this bearing one another's burdens, or having our burdens borne by others.
We're going to call each other to prayer in song this morning. If you take your green, sing the journey. It'll be easier to follow along with instructions if you have it open to page 79. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 5. And women and girls, would you please sing verse 1? It says, "O sisters, let's go down." And if all the men and boys would sing verse 2, where it says, "O brothers, let's go down." And then we'll end singing together verse 5. And we'll do the refrains all together as well. We begin with the refrain, and then women sing out, and then men sing out, and we'll end with verse 5.
As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way.
Women.
Oh, sisters, let's go down, let's go down, come on. As I went down.
if you'd gather now in groups of five or six with those near you and pray for the needs you've heard shared already this morning, or you can use those two-sentence prayers that are printed in the bulletin to help guide your prayer time. And share with one another your needs, make them known to each other and to God, or thank. Say a prayer of thanks for someone who's helped you in the past or the way that you were helped.
Even if you haven't finished your time of prayer for one another, I encourage you to turn in your purple, sing the story. We're jumping between books today in this one, and we'll have our final song of sending. 121 near the back of the songs, Nothing is Lost on the Breath of God. This familiar tune has words put to it that remind us that nothing that was shared in these groups, nothing that you're carrying this morning is too small for God. Sometimes we don't share with one another because we think, oh, there are much bigger things in the world. There are much more important things. Nobody needs to worry about mine. And this song should be an affirmation that even your small concerns and cares and need for help are important in God's eyes and thus important in the eyes of the congregation. So let's sing this reminder to one another, number 121. I invite you to stand as you are able. 121 in the purple. Nothing is lost in the breath of God. Go in peace because this community loves you. Go in peace because God loves you. Go in peace.